Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for our webinar on the reality of artists in mental health. My name is Ty Furman. I am the managing director of the BU Arts Initiative here at Boston University, and my pronouns are he, him. I am a 52-year-old white male with a scruffy beard, wearing a short sleeve green button-down shirt. And I am sitting in my office, but I have a visual image of an art display as my background. Before we begin today, I'd like to acknowledge that here at Boston University, the land that we're operating on is the ancestral unceded homeland of the Massachusetts people and their neighbors, the Nipmuc and the Wampanoag. We acknowledge the painful history of settler colonialism, genocide, and forced removal from this territory. And we honor, respect, and celebrate the many Indigenous peoples still connected to this land. We also publicly have committed to working to end continued systems of oppression and violence against Indigenous, Black, and in particular this year, Asian and Asian American friends and colleagues and other people of color. You can learn who the original inhabitants and stewards of the land that you are operating on by going to native-land.ca, that's native-land.ca, and we encourage you to explore the full history of the area in which you live. I'm really pleased that we're presenting this webinar today and grateful to my colleague Tanya, who will introduce herself in a few moments, for bringing the idea to us and working with me. Tanya is in the Boston University School of Music, and it was really a pleasure to work with her in putting this together. Now I'm going to pass it off to our moderator and my colleague and friend, Carrie.
Thank you, Ty. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Carrie Landa. I use she, her pronouns. I am a Latina and white woman in my early 40s. I have long brown hair and I'm wearing tortoise shell glasses. I'm sitting against a gray background with some artwork on the wall. I serve as the Director of Behavioral Medicine and the Associate Director for Student Health Services here at Boston University. I've worked very closely with Ty and his colleagues at the BU Arts Initiative on several events over the past few years, which has been really a pleasure. And I'm really grateful to be asked to be moderating today's really important panel. Next, I'm going to introduce Tanya, who will speak a little bit about herself.
Thank you, Carrie. Hello, everyone. My name is Tanya Gabrielian, and my pronouns are she, her. I'm in my 30s, half Middle Eastern, half Asian, with long dark hair and a black sweater against a somewhat neutral background. I'm a classical pianist, and I've performed around the world on four continents in halls, including Carnegie Hall, Sydney Opera House, and Wigmore Hall, and with orchestras, including the LA Philharmonic, Royal Scottish National Orchestra, and the Sydney Symphony. As a freelancing musician, I've maintained a touring schedule for over a decade now. The irony of being a musician is that everybody thinks it's quite glamorous because all you see are the gowns, the spotlights, and the hallowed stages that you get to perform on. But the actual work is extremely isolating. You're constantly on the road. You're working with orchestras that don't even acknowledge you when you solo with them. And you travel so much that you really can't keep track of what city you are in when you wake up. Music's a really competitive field, and to show weakness would really hurt your career. The schedule itself is quite physically, mentally, and spiritually grueling, but also the way that the industry works. Me Too has not permeated classical music for a number of reasons, and sexual harassment is extremely prevalent. Colleagues are competitive and backstabbing at times, and everybody presents a really happy face to try to get more performances when we're actually broke, exhausted, and invalidated for feeling this way because the fact that we must love what we do. So I've been using music as a means to bring awareness to mental health issues for over a decade now, but I realize that I've focused on general issues of mental health and not the actual mental health of musicians themselves. So we don't see music as an outlet for therapy, nor do we find comfort in what we're doing, because when a hobby becomes your profession, it's a very different relationship. So I'm honored to be here today to contribute to this conversation about mental health and the well-being of artists. I'd like to now pass on to my colleague, Edson.
Okay, Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to be here. My name is Edson Filho, and I'm Associate Professor of Sports Psychology here at BU. So I use he, him as a pronouns. I'm a Latino, dark skin, Brazilian. I have a big hair at the moment. I have a quarantine hair growing. So I like it very much. What else? I have a colorful shirt and a boring white bag. My research and applied work is with performance optimization. So what I try to do is bring people from a functional level to a higher level of performance. But we also know that sometimes performance drops, and that's when there is a drop, we call this performance restoration. And that's very much related to well-being. In the past, I've studied Olympic athletes, Cirque du Soleil performers, I've worked with professional musicians, and all of them want the same thing, to feel well and perform at peak level, to be in flow. I also studied high-performing teams and groups, because one thing is to perform at peak level as an individual. The other thing is to perform at the peak level as a group. We call high-performing teams. So you might be very confident yourself, but you don't trust your teammate. So I study both individual and group levels of performance. And in a nutshell, what we want with people is, again, that they feel well from a biological, psychological, and social standpoint. So a broad scope for health, and also to perform at peak level, and ideally be confident, be able to self-regulate. A big part of psychology and sport exercise and performance psychology, as we call, is to help people to be able to self-regulate and adapt and be confident. So that's me in a little brief summary. Now I wanna pass the torch to Carolina.
Thank you, Edson. My name is Caroline Whiddon. I am the co-founder and executive director of Me Too Orchestra. I am a 51-year-old white female who uses she, her pronouns. I'm wearing my reading glasses today. I have a shoulder-length brown hair with a black turtleneck and a very neutral background, and I'm sitting on my bouncy ball, so you may see me moving throughout my screen a little bit to help with my back pain today. I have a bachelor's degree in French horn performance from the Eastman School of Music. And not long after completing my bachelor's degree, I was diagnosed with depression, generalized anxiety disorder, and panic attacks. So I know very well what it feels like to be 23, 24 years old and to literally feel as though you are going to have a heart attack and die from anxiety. I left behind what I had anticipated would be a performing career and went into orchestra management full time. And about 10 years ago, I met the man who would later become my husband, and my entire career trajectory changed at that point. This man is Ronald Brownstein. He's a phenomenal conductor, and he has bipolar disorder. I met Ronald first as a colleague, and then I witnessed him being fired during a time when he was experiencing the manifestations of his bipolar disorder and asking for time to adjust his medication, for some accommodations to get his mental health back into a stable place. But instead, he was immediately fired. I stood by him as a colleague throughout that period, and personally, we both left the organization we were with, and after that, he came to me and said, I want to start an orchestra for people like me. Together, we launched the first Me Too Ensemble in Burlington, Vermont in 2011. We now have a series of Me Too orchestras and ensembles in 5 different states, and there are no auditions, no fees, and of course, no stigma associated with being a part of one of our ensembles. About 50% of our musicians are living with some sort of diagnosis they have chosen to disclose to us. And together, we're hoping to create a very supportive and stigma-free rehearsal environment that chips away at the self-stigmatization that happens with people who are living with mental health disorders. And then through our performances, which include both inspiring music and very inspiring stories from people who live with a diagnosis, we hope to erase the stigma. And with that, I'm going to pass things along to Peter.
Thank you so much. Hello, everyone. My name is Peter Andrew Danzig. I use they, them pronouns, and I identify as a genderqueer Latinx mixed race person with an invisible disability. I am wearing glasses and facial hair. You should be able to identify. And if you cannot see color pretty easily, I'm wearing two necklaces today, so that might help to identify me. I graduated from Temple University with an undergrad degree in communications and theater. I have a master's degree as an acting scholar from Villanova University and a master's degree from Bryn Mawr in social service. Just a little bit about my background. For about 15 years, I worked professionally in the performing arts, primarily in musical theater and film and television. At that time, I had been fairly active in advocating for the traumatic experiences of actors, particularly queer populations within the community, and identified as a trauma survivor. As part of my thesis of my master's program at Villanova, I founded a research collective and nonprofit called Theatrical Trainer. And our work primarily is focused on the biopsychosocial support of artists across the country. We question the needs and requests of the industry upon the body and the ways that it impacts their mental, physical, and social well-being. Since that time, we have been in research for about 6 years. And recently, I have transitioned as a psychotherapist, primarily treating mental health issues and supports for artists and queer populations. I like to think of my work as not so much that I hold knowledge. I consider it me-search versus research, as identifying as part of the artistic community. And in that time, we've also recently started a project, which we'll talk about a little bit later, called the Body Aesthetic Project, which asks artists about their experiences in the arts industry and the marginalization of artists as a profession nationally. It's fairly common that artists feel that they can't have a voice, that they have to be quote unquote grateful just to work. And a lot of my research just really primarily challenges the ideas of the starving artists and forcing artists not to advocate for themselves. I think that my work is always and always will be around just the sustainability as art, as social and important to the well-being of society. So I am so excited about the opportunity for us to have more of these conversations around the intersections of mental health and also the isolation of different modalities and practice methods within the arts, such as dancers, musicians, painters. We are all siloed, but yet we are all, as you will hear, I'm sure, throughout this conversation, really struggling with a lot of the same hardships and issues that culminate in, I think, a larger conversation around what it means to be an artist and how vital that service is to society. And maybe today we can even dig up a little bit about where that idea comes from, where we internalize it, and how we all can change it going forward. So I'm very grateful to be a part of this conversation and thank Ty for bringing me here. I think I'd like to take the liberty now of introducing again Dr. Carrie Landa to bring us all in for a conversation.
Great. Thank you all so much for those wonderful introductions of yourselves. So just for the format for today, I'm going to start off the conversation with a few questions directed at the panelists, but we invite all of the participants in the webinar today to submit questions through the Q&A, and those will be fed to me so that I can actually ask them and direct them to the panelists specifically. So without further ado, I'm getting started. So you know, just thinking a little bit about the different kind of issues that might present for individuals who perform. Edson, I actually a question specifically for you. What similarities do you see in artists and athletes, perhaps, and ways in which their mental health or even well-being can impact their performance and delivery?
I think it's pretty much the same in a sense, because both athletes and performers, they need to be physically and mentally and socially well to perform at the peak level. What we know from research is that different domains have different performance challenges. And one of the things we do, we call performance profiling. We try to identify those challenges. Those challenges come from the person, individual factors, from the context, and from the tasks they perform. For instance, I give an example from some research of Cirque du Soleil. So circus artists perform jugglers, they are high risk of burnout because they practice alone. Contortionists, they are pain. So they quit because of pain management, and that can develop to more serious clinical issues. And if you go to sport, for instance, some sports that are based on external referees, gymnastics, any sort of sport performance that you have referee giving you a grade, giving you your scoring, that leads to external regulation, which in turn can lead to low self-esteem, which can lead to eating disorders. So instead of self-regulation, we have external regulation. So the broader point is, depending on the context, on the individual factors, you might have different performance challenges that might lead to clinical issues. And on the other side, some context lead to clinical issues that impact performance. So in the end of the day, what do we want, as I mentioned before, is that athletes and performers, they are able to self-regulate. And to do that, it's the magic word that we see everywhere, is resilience and being mentally tough, right? What is it? It's the ability to adapt, essentially, right? Sometimes you have to change your self-talk. Sometimes you have to change your attentional regulation. Sometimes it's about communication skills. So I tell the people I work with, it's like having many channels on your TV, right? And you change it, right? Sometimes it's better that you challenge some thoughts. Cognitive behavioral techniques, sometimes better that you observe those thoughts through mindfulness. So different sports, different contexts lead to different issues, but the ultimate goal is to be able to have people able to self-regulate and to be resilient, be able to bounce back and adapt. I hope that helps a little bit.
That's great. Thank you so much, Edson. So actually, Peter, kind of a similar question for you, given your clinical work. Are there different ways in which you see artists struggle, either, you know, based on the type of art that they're performing or the medium in which they're performing from, or whether they're an individual or part of a larger orchestra?
This is a really great question, one I think that probably a lot of clinicians are really struggling with. I see performance artists really kind of indicating what Edson mentioned, the requirements of the physical demands of the job. So in a lot of my research, body dysmorphia is very high amongst performing artists and dancers particularly. Whereas some of the clinical work that I might do with the painter is very much siloed. I have a lot of painters who come with physical demands of pain in carpal tunnel and dealing with that kind of chronic pain, and also isolation in their work, not wanting to be public facing, letting their work speak for them. Similarly, vocalists and performing artists, again, comparison work to emulate kind of these standards, particularly white patriarchal standards of work, which very much impact their mental health. So one of the things that I tend to try and do when clinically working with my population is just to ask what brought them to the arts in the first place. And many times one of the things that I find is very fascinating and is helpful to consider is that the arts is usually the place where young minds go to find comfort, to find expression, acceptance, calm. And they are under the impression as they study that going forward, maybe in college settings and afterwards professionally, that the environment that they may have had in high school and such and younger will be the same. That's when a lot of mental health, supports aren't available, when they enter the industry and realize there's a lot of marginalization. So a lot of the work that I tend to do is person and environment. I think we try and just bridge the arts under this one large gap of work. And I think that we're not necessarily quite understanding of the degree of consistent repetition that comes across all of the modalities that they do, and the intense hours, unpredictability, basic hierarchy of needs, food, shelter, and comforts. Those things are things that artists don't take for granted, that they don't easily have access for. And yet a lot of their complaints, their presenting problems, is that their work is often taken in by the public so quickly and so much, and they feel like they're taken from, but they often say, well, where do I get back? How do I refill my cup emotionally? Who do I turn to? Are there social services available? And so that's some of the work that I see clinically that also, you know, permeates the populations.
Thank you, Peter. That's actually a great segue asking, Tanya, given kind of the stages that you've performed on and kind of the landscape in which you've navigated to be successful in your career, you know, what are the ways in which you see kind of the competitive aspects of performance really impacting individuals' health and well-being?
I'm sorry about that. I was muted. Pre-COVID or post-COVID? Because it's a very...
We could do a both.
It's been absolutely just a disaster for all the arts. You know, I mean, especially because this country doesn't necessarily think of the arts as important and what's going on with the organizations. There's no government support. You know, nobody's playing concerts. You know, to go from a schedule of, I don't think I was in the same place longer than 2 weeks years, to being stuck in the same place for now, you know, a year solidly. It's just a huge shock to the system. We're not performing. We're not doing what we've done since we were three. And, you know, and when you talk to other people, everybody comes from different financial backgrounds, but, you know, people are having to get jobs and, you know, doing, you know, just at Target just to survive, so that, because you're not making money at this time. I'm losing sight of the question now. I'm so bad. I'm sorry. In terms of support from colleagues, even before that, you're all competing for the same spot. You really are. Even the student teacher dynamic, you're still competing for the same spot. You know, how many people outside of the arts have ever gone to a solo classical concert? You know, very few under the age of 70, and even then, not many, you know. And also just when you talk to your colleagues and friends about what's going on, everybody sort of makes this mental hierarchy of where everybody else is, thinking they're doing better than me, they're doing worse than me. So when you complain to somebody and saying, you know, like the hardships of performing and how exhausted you are from you have concerts, you shouldn't be complaining. You know, you get that a lot. Or when you're trying to get more concerts and you're working with people to get that, they take the concert away from you somehow and directly contact the organizer. And because it's so competitive, there's really no support for each other. And again, to sort of have this network where we really need support and there's no space for anybody, you just create an environment that's super toxic. And when you start talking about it, you appear weak, you appear unreliable, and you seem to be complaining. So you're not gonna be hired in that situation. So, you know, there's just a lot of sort of nuances to this that are so difficult to navigate, especially with, you know, not many people to turn to that really can be supportive of you in that.
Right. You know, pulling from kind of Edson's and Peter's points earlier, really that kind of internal management system, whether that's kind of resilience that you pull from or your own personal belief system or support systems outside of your kind of circle of colleagues or peers that you might very well be competing with, really highlights the importance of having those in place. Caroline, given the work that your organization does and your own personal experience, as well as your partner's experience about stigma, have you seen a shift in the way that, whether it's your colleagues or the kind of performance community talks about mental health or illness?
Well, certainly. I mean, it's been amazing, especially during the pandemic. I think everybody's focus has turned to mental health in a way that it just wasn't there before. When I think about my time in music school, we never would have broached a conversation like this. And it truly wasn't that long ago. So the fact that I've been asked to speak on so many panels about mental health during the pandemic tells me that we're maybe headed in the right direction, although it could also speak to the fact that we're all just way more mentally on unsettled ground. You know, we're trying to find our footing. So this by necessity has risen. There does seem to be more room in the professional field to talk about mental illness, or at least some degree of mental illness. I think we're at a place in society where depression and anxiety kind of, and this is not to to discount anyone's experience, but kind of low level mental health is acceptable. You can talk about it. When you get into talking about treatment resistant depression and OCD and bipolar disorder and schizophrenia, it's still so stigmatized. I have a dear friend from school who sits in a very prominent position in one of the world's greatest orchestras. And I noticed that a few years ago, he gave an interview where he spoke very openly about his struggle with an addiction to alcohol. A few years later, he disclosed to me in a private message that he also has bipolar disorder. And it was so notable to me that he felt comfortable with a certain level of disclosure around addiction, but not with going the extra mile to really to talk about his mental health issues. I don't blame him for that. I blame all the people around him for that. You know, we often, my husband and I often hear from our colleagues in the professional music world, oh, you started an orchestra for people with mental illnesses. How is that different than the New York Philharmonic or the Philadelphia Orchestra? And, you know, that's the joke, but really the difference is Me Too is about creating a space where we can actually talk about it. Our colleagues who have these professional positions do not feel safe talking about it. I'll also share with you that I served on a panel last month with Towson State University in their music department. And I was so struck by the fact that the faculty member who invited us, when he showed up on the screen, he had a t-shirt that in large print said, "This is a stigma-free zone." And I was so struck by the power of his t-shirt. That there are students who would pass him in the hallway and he would be making this announcement that you're in a safe space, because that's so far from what I experienced as a young musician. And I think it speaks volumes about his employer, frankly, that he could say that he could disclose his own illness with bipolar disorder and know that he was in a safe space for himself to do that. So there are glimmers of hope out there, but we still have a lot of work to do.
Thank you. For those of you that are engaged in performance in some capacity, whether that's theater, piano, or instrument, how have you, you know, Tanya, you made the point about the pandemic kind of being so different and kind of figuring out the new challenges that everyone has had to navigate, you know, whether you're in performance or in accounting, right? Everyone has had to figure out how to do this in some different way. Can any of you share strategies perhaps you have used to kind of navigate some of this? And if you have not personally kind of had to lean in on those, what tips have you shared with kind of patients or clients that you're working with? Maybe we'll go, Peter, go ahead.
I have a very exciting question that is probably gonna stimulate all of us. I recently served on a panel for trauma-informed practice in the arts for Villanova as an alumni. And one of the faculty members said, well, you know, based on your experiences here, what could we have done better? What would a trauma-informed audition room look like? And my eyes got big, because to me, a trauma-informed audition room means that I can ask for accommodations. I can ask to start again if I'm having an anxiety attack. You may not give me music to memorize the night before and expect me to stay up all night having it perfect and not hold the piece of paper. If I'm shaking while auditioning, asking, is there anything we could do to make you feel more comfortable? All of those things would just be lovely. But if you think about, you know, the other side of the table, that we've created this environment where the competition fuels people to not ask for needs or their accommodations. They get 3 minutes, and we love to say, we have 3,000 people to see today. If you can't do it, there's somebody else. And it dismisses the humanity of a person so quickly. And then that's permeated as being replaceable so quickly, you know? And so I've started asking clients, you know, why don't you ask what when they ask you to audition, whatever your modality is, or submit your visual art, do you have any accommodations available in this process? And when people step back, they realize it's a gap in their services. That's their work to do. It's not ours as the artist. So I just kind of wanted to throw that out. So I'm very excited about that question for us all to ask nationally. How it happens, I don't know the answer fully, but I think it starts in places like this.
That is, it is promising that people are even having the discussion, because that's how, you know, change is of course going to start. Tanya, were you going to chime in?
I've been so sidetracked. The question originally was about with the pandemic. I can't even remember.
So I was so moved by
Peter's suggestion that I was just like completely lost track.
So the question that I had posed to the group was, how has, as individuals, have you managed your own mental health and wellness during the pandemic, you know, specifically right. related to your arts or the work that you do with individuals in the arts?
So in a way, COVID saved my life. I had worked myself so much to the point of exhaustion prior. I should also mention that I am now a professor at BU in the piano department. And I went this route because I had cancer. And as a performing musician, when you have cancer, you can't perform. You don't really have health insurance. You can't pay your rent. You know, and there's just no safe. I got dumped by my manager, you know, that there was absolutely sort of no safety net in there at all. So you have to take every gig because you need the money. You know, you're constantly worried about, can I pay the rent this month? I don't have any bookings for that month. How am I going to save for that? But that doesn't quite add up, that you really don't think about your own well-being. And I'm pretty sure I had no genetic predisposition to cancer. And I'm pretty sure my body gave up. And I was at a point, now that I took a place in academia, that I was exactly at the same point. I was overworked. I was exhausted. I was keeping my touring schedule exactly as it was before while maintaining this academic job for the security that I knew that I needed, because I need health insurance. I need disability insurance in case there's a recurrence or anything in my future. And for the first time in my life, I've gotten to stop. And, you know, just doing the university work is actually pretty easy because it's so few hours compared to how much time you have to be on the road and traveling and prepping and practicing. And, you know, not to mention the fact that you're practicing completely alone as a pianist. So, you know, all this isolation during COVID is very normal for me because, you know, as a freelancer, all you do is practice at home. But really, like, I took 3 months off and didn't play a note, and it was glorious. I didn't miss it one bit. You know, it's pretty much the only time that we're accepted. It's acceptable to have a break in your schedule. And, you know, I found it very revitalizing until it got to the point where you're just like, well, my whole identity is in my work. I'm so used to being busy all the time. I haven't even developed hobbies outside because I've had no time to do that. And with the narrow focus that we have, since I've been playing piano since the age of 3, you know, on very competitively, very focused on this career, my interests outside of music are so limited because of the amount of time I've had to devote to this. So I think for all of us, we're just kind of in shock of like, how do you survive without performing, without making music with other people? You know, for me, the point of music is not just for me to play on stage by myself, but to collaborate, to play with other musicians. And that's totally gone. And that's, for me, the good part of music. And, you know, for that part to be gone and it's just me practicing, it's not a happy time. And I know I'm lucky to have a teaching job now financially, but it's for my colleagues that don't, you know, I don't see the way that we're going to come out of it, because this problem is not because of the pandemic. The pandemic has just sort of brought the end date of the, you know, the situation to a really a boiling point where we have to address, you know, why do we have art in this society, and how, why do we not value it more?
Carrie, I just want to add one point, because I think Tanya, she just said a lot of things I want to say. One thing that athletes, performers across the board need to understand is that recovery is part of the training, right? There is a model called recovery stress balance. So performers don't recover. And this recovery needs to be, again, biological, psychological, and social. And the other thing, essentially, we teach performance three things. There's active recovery, you go for a run, you go do yoga. There's passive, you watch on TV, Netflix, right? And there's proactive recovery. You do something you usually don't do, right? You know, you call your cousin, you try to cook something new. And what we see is that usually, I work with an ultramarathonist. What he wants to do for recovery is to go for a run. I tell him no, right? Usually we try to do what it's more comfortable. So one thing is teach people about recovery stress balance. For you to be able to self-regulate, you need to be self-aware. Awareness precedes regulation. We know that from research. The other thing she said that's very interesting is entrapment. You feel entrapped, right? And you burn out. Burnout, and then it's depression. Right? Depressed mood for some time, and then from there, other issues. So you feel entrapped because your self, it's single identity, right? And what we want a self-complexity, right? We want people to be complex. If it's not going well at work, you have the family. It's not going well at family, I don't know, you go to church. If it's not going well there, I don't know, you sing, right? So that's the other thing. And the last thing, I don't want to dominate the conversation, but she said something like perfectionism. Perfectionism is a big problem. First, actually we're saying risk that is adaptive and maladaptive perfectionism. Perfectionism is high standards. You want to do well. Maladaptive is external regulation. You do it for somebody else. And if it's outside of your control, you're in trouble by definition, right? So perfectionism is very prevalent in arts, in sports, because it's very difficult for people to make it, right, in these domains. It's very competitive. Most people won't be millionaires. So perfectionism is an issue. And so that people can avoid this problem, they need to be, again, self-aware on how to deal with this external regulation, how to bring regulation to themselves, so they develop the inside, right? We say as within, so without, so they can do better outside. So yeah, just those three thoughts: recovery, stress balance, perfectionism, and entrapment. They always connected to mental health issues and performance issues.
So, you know, there are so many things that contribute to how an individual functions, you know, and I think part of it is an individual's identity, again, the resources that individuals pull from, and those are so variable for each person. Peter, I can throw this at you first, and if others want to kind of share as well, are there ways in which you have seen some strategies work better overall for populations like artists and performers, or is it really just like, you know, what I can say as a psychologist, kind of, it's not one size fits all, and you really do need to identify kind of how an individual wants to work with the provider that they're working with.
Carrie, that's such a great question, and I'm so glad to have a psychologist who also acknowledges just the person environment, because often in research we really lump people into these areas. And, you know, one of the things that I'm transparent with my clients about is, you know, managed care sometimes dictates the kind of therapy that's popular amongst clinicians, and they impose that as a modality in which they also can sustain themselves. There's systemic problems in many industries. And so one of the things is there is no one size fits all. I did do a 1-year pre-IRB study, which we're going to be hopefully getting nationally with IRB approval now. Asking artists if they viewed art therapy as any way supportive. And we had artists at every intersection, from poets to writers to dancers to Cirque du Soleil performers to art, and all of them across the board. That's where I thought Tanya's moment of saying I didn't play a note for months was therapeutic. All of them in this study said no. Every participant said no. The thing that they did find that they thought worked very well. Now, if we're talking about intersections of trauma, it's a little different. So I'm going to put, clinical trauma, sexual assault, traumatic events here for a moment. Many people enjoyed DBT as a means of working. They also really did enjoy simple quality of life questions. So one of the things was CBT is popular, but the original basis of CBT is identifying a behavioral, maladaptive behavior and correcting that behavior or intercepting it ahead of time. And asking people to allow themselves to wake up in the morning and not feel pressure to rehearse something just because they need to always be on point or ready to intercept and listen to their body. Many times there was a distortion between their emotional needs and their bodies. Like they wouldn't be able to listen to their bodies. They would just be outside of it. And then for trauma, for a lot of the artists who encountered trauma, The Body Keeps the Score, I tell people, is a great book, a great asset. Just in terms of thinking about how important it is to acknowledge your body's needs and that it takes time. So somatic work worked very well for those populations. And ironically, switching people's modalities of creativity, sometimes I do in therapy. So I will ask a dancer to draw sometimes during therapy to regulate with me. And I'll say, I can't draw. And I say, well, neither can I. So let's just draw. And asking a painter sometimes who is so focused on this part of the body and they just cannot open up the availability of just their chest cavity to even acknowledge sometimes they just stretch with me and move and dance and they burst out into tears, and just because there's availability that people don't have. So interdisciplinary, that's why I think interdisciplinary work is work that we need to be doing. And I think it's helpful.
Thank you for that. Just as an appendix to some of what Peter shared, DBT is dialectical behavior therapy and CBT is cognitive behavior therapy. And both of these kind of therapies or strategies that clinicians use to work with clients are really about targeting individuals' thoughts and sometimes the behaviors associated with those thoughts. That's a very 101 primer, but just for those who are not versed in different therapies. I want to think a little bit about also kind of resources that are broad. I think on our campus, we always talk about kind of health and well-being, a shared campus responsibility. So it's not just the work of clinicians to support individuals who might struggle. It's the work of professors. It's the work of employers. It's the work of our entire community. So are there resources that all of you, there's of course things like Psychology Today, or you can go on your insurance website and find providers, but what are the resources that you all have found valuable in encouraging folks to work on these issues that we're talking about? And each of you can share, maybe start with Caroline on my right.
Gosh, my first thought was to any students that are listening to this, please take advantage of the mental health resources you have on campus, because I think, and the other panelists can weigh in on this, but after college, it doesn't get easier in terms of finding support. I have a niece who is very public about her battle with OCD, and she's at college in South Carolina. And I'm amazed, honestly, at the resources that are available on campus. So I would very strongly say, if you're struggling, and it doesn't have to be, that you're having hallucinations or that you're, struggling with addiction. It can be just stress or making life decisions that are a little scary and daunting. That I love therapy. It's so good, and take advantage of it right now while it's relatively easy to access on campus. So I'll start the conversation just with that thought.
Thank you. So I'm going to my left. Peter's next.
I also will just really advocate for therapy that is available on college campuses. I too myself, in all of my programs, just didn't take advantage of the student counseling center. And I think there's a little bit of stigma there. Who will see me? Is this going to be seen as a weakness? Is this going to cost me the show? you know. So that's one thing. Also, in addition, I love Psychology Today. There's also a really great website that is called The Mighty. And it's got a lot of contributions from artists who and people who talk about their experience with mental health and their hardship finding a therapist or their hardship having a therapist hear them, you know. So one of the things is also the anecdotes of not necessarily it always being a clinical support from an insurance company or a behavioral health center, but sometimes just a community of people that get it, kind of like what Caroline has created. There are many places out there also with just people that can understand what you're going through. Support groups that aren't clinically run sometimes are really wonderful places. Again, they don't, you know, replace clinical interventions, but they are a place for community. And then I'll also just also advocate for right now, therapy is accessible in ways that it never has been because of the pandemic. I'm not saying that it's better, but we are accessible across the world now to people to support them in different ways. And I advise people if they're not feeling like they're finding help with their current clinician or therapist, we're okay if you say, this is not working, I need help. Don't feel like you have to stay with somebody if you don't feel heard. Always feel like you can advocate for what you need because it's your life. So that's just very important for me to always say. I guess I'll throw it over to Tanya.
Okay. I mean, I advocate for all my students to go to therapy as much as possible because first of all, and I don't always practice what I preach, but if you're not okay, everything you do is affected. And, you know, this sort of selfless giving of yourself of performing, like you can't do that if you have nothing left to give when you're running on empty. So, you know, really you have to, it's a selfish thing, but it's the only way for survival. Cause if you're not caring about yourself, no one else is going to. While you're in school, it is always much easier to go through a counseling center on campus than it is actually in the real world to find therapy. I've had lots of problems. I think all musicians, probably all artists, know people that have committed suicide that are in the arts. And I remember when one of my close friends did that, it took me 6 months to even get an appointment with one therapist, you know? And again, it's an issue that it's just not easy. And people's with also with the pay structure of that. And if what does insurance cover that? Can I afford to do that? Well, can you afford not to do that? I think is the question that's much more meaningful. And also talk to your friends and to your support people about what's actually going on. You know, what happens to these people that kill themselves? We don't know. We had no idea this was going to happen. And we're all struggling. Like, I don't think anybody, even the richest person in the world, is gonna say they're having a happy life, you know, or an easy life. So if you just start talking about, and also know that the friends that you talk to about it are also going through their own stuff. So maybe they're not in a place to have that discussion or it triggers something for themselves, but you know, but just start the conversation and trust the people that you love and support you to really be there for you when you need it.
I just also want to jump in. You know, I think some of the content of what we're talking about obviously can be kind of triggering or upsetting even for individuals listening to this. You know, we're talking about, you know, even what Tanya's discussing and death by suicide. It is hard. It's hard to talk about. It's hard to hear about. So, you know, as we're having the discussion, remember to take care of yourself. You know, we are putting resources as we're mentioning them into the chat or into the for everyone to see, for the attendees to see as well. But know that there are certainly resources available. I think part of this, though, you know, the conversations that we're having around this, whether there is, you know, stigma around these issues or whether they're issues that are hard to talk about, these are important conversations. And we're recognizing that the ways in which individuals in the arts struggle may have felt very unique because of the performance schedules or the competition schedules. But the theme that I keep on hearing this is this sense of kind of disconnection and loneliness as you're going through this really arduous process of performing and competing. And I think if the world can all relate to something right now, it's disconnection and loneliness. So, you know, clinicians and being able to access mental health resources is incredibly important. And I thank you for the plug, Caroline, initially in talking about encouraging students and individuals to utilize those resources. What are some of the other resources that folks have talked about? Peter, you talked about having a community around you, whether that's a community of peers or a community of individuals who might be going through the same process. But What's some other resources that folks might mention?
Carrie, can I just say that in the sports psych track, we have a lot of students doing the masters, very qualified, and that's a resource we have at BU, right? We work with musicians, we work with athletes, so that's a resource right there. So I would suggest people to reach out to the resource within the university. Just one thing I want to add is that when you ask performers, musicians, athletes, people across the board, how much of their performance depends on the mental game, people say from 80 to 90%. But they don't spend, they don't invest that time in the mental aspect, right? So that's one thing that I like to highlight, because working with high performing people, it is always tough. It advances, it comes back. You have to continue working on the mental side. And the one thing that I always ask people, performers, and I realize sometimes they forgot the answer. Why do you do that? For you to be in flow, you need to be in love with that, right? And people forget, right? I start playing football because I like the second before I would score. I knew it's gonna be a goal. You ask a goalkeeper, they say, look, I like to punch the ball because I'm confident that I'm gonna, you ask a musician something else. And I when work with this pianist, I asked her, she forgot. She is world-class pianist. Work with this ultramarathonist, he forgot, right? So reconnect, because sometimes you have to change how you feel. Sometimes you have to change how you think, right? Change how you feel, change how you change how you feel, change how you think, you change how you think, you change how you behave, right? To call cognitive affective behavioral link. And a lot of the, many times the answer is in the emotional component. But back to you, Carrie, I just want to stick this point in there.
What about others, other non-clinical resources that either you yourself have benefited from or you've really encouraged peers or colleagues to utilize?
Okay, this may be slightly off topic or slightly off target, but I've been thinking a lot about Tanya's career and how when Tanya goes out to perform professionally, she makes a point of identifying, in her case, it's someone within kind of the mental health community to perform for. And to me, it seems like, I'll put this on you, Tanya, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like that's your way as a performer of making sure that along with the professional and the joy that you bring to your professional role, that you also want to do something that brings you kind of a different kind of human joy and connection. And I think for anybody listening to this panel who is a performer, there can be real value to just seeking out those opportunities to perform for maybe another kind of disenfranchised audience or people who don't normally get to experience your art form, that there are kind of two tracks that we exist on, that one is the professional track, but you can also use your art to heal yourself by putting yourself in situations that you might not normally be in, playing for people who will really appreciate it. And you don't have to necessarily worry about perfection, which is another topic that keeps coming up in this. So I would throw that out there. It's obviously not a clinical resource, but something that we can do for ourselves.
Tanya.
Bounce off that. Okay, my brain is just going blank today. I've always told people and my students in particular, that the qualities that you need to be a successful musician make you a horrible person. And, that shameless self-promotion and constantly thinking that you're good enough to be on a stage, literally on a platform under a spotlight with the audience below in the darkness applauding your every move is really just twisted when you think about it objectively. And so for me, when I started doing this work, I went to a mental health hospital, a hospital in when I was living in New York, and it was in my neighborhood. So it was primarily a Dominican area, and people were there for 30-day stays. And musicians always talk about, can music really help people? Oh yes, it really does, you know, but also the audience that you're serving, do you really feel connected to those people? For me, my case, not really, you know, and the conversations after performances, you're just like, what planet am I on? And I disappear to the bathroom just to collect myself to be like, this is a parallel universe. I wish I had a seat at the table in, but I don't. And so, you know, to then also, I made the parallel between playing a lot of composers with mental health issues for these people. So I played some Schumann, and this guy in the audience raises, you know, and Schumann had bipolar. He tried to commit suicide 3 times. Last 2 years of his life were in a mental institution. And so this guy identifies with Schumann, and he's never, you know, they haven't gone to classical music concerts before. And for him to find that identity with the Schumann, for me, was something really that was very meaningful, in that, you know, we're so obsessed with perfection and these little details that we forget that it can actually, you know, affect somebody on that level of, you know, it's not going to change their life. It's not going to cure them. It's not going to get them out of their situation. But for just a second, they can see, you know, that other people have gone through this also and identify with that. And we feel so much more connected when we identify with people. And I don't know when you would feel less connected when you're actually, you know, in a mental hospital for a 30-day mandatory stay. So, you know, it's also, for me, it's easier to go on stage to talk about these things than to make it all about me, which is something that I've struggled with throughout my career, of that just that sort of focus that needs to be on yourself to get further.
Thank you, Tanya. I also want to think, you know, are there spaces you all have talked about? I mean, Caroline, you've obviously kind of identified a need for something and then went and created it, which is incredible. What are the other types of things that you all, as again, either practitioners or performers or researchers, you wish were available as resources or what we could advocate for? And, you know, thinking about that on an individual level or a systems level, whether that's as an employer or as an institution like a university, or even as a community of artists.
I am so excited about that question. I feel kind of like split in two, because I, as an artist and as a therapist, it's like switching hats, you know? But one of the things that I think is helpful is early on in college settings, where we are teaching impressionable minds, that they're deferring to us for support. There's always been this concept of we're going to break you down and then build you back up. And I think systemically, I see, Tanya, I know that you must hear in some way. I know as an artist or a dancer, they would say that you have to dance and dance and dance until it is perfect. And I would be up until like 2 a.m. dancing in a studio that I rented out on campus, because I just had to be, it had to be right, you know? And I never stopped. Nobody ever said to me, what are some of the qualities of life that you might like in your life? Like for me, I like to be in bed around 9:30 reading a book. Therefore, a professional theater career fully and I'm a member of all those unions and I did all the things, the quality of life didn't match what I liked as a person. But nobody ever asked me that question. Instead, it was, how do you mold yourself to just fit the standards of what this industry has decided? And so the reason I bring that up is we forget to ask ourselves those questions of ourselves. Young, what do I enjoy? What kind of life do I want to live? Do I like performing late at night? Would that make me happy? And then also, I think we need to instill resiliency in our students. So I think in academic settings, starting to dismantle some of this stigma that we all hear here. All 3 of us on the panel, or 4 of us, have talked about performance standards being very high. And I found that there's this, you know, thing we call allostatic load, that my ability to carry perfectionism got higher and higher and higher until I literally, similar time, broke. My body broke. I had knee surgeries. I couldn't do it anymore. I wasn't able to sing. Things were just not working because my barrier got so high. And I think it is part of our responsibility as teachers, community organizers, people creating these spaces, for us to keep asking what is wrong with this equation? How can I help? And just keep having these dialogues to say in your classrooms, it's okay to take care of yourself. It's okay to say, I can't perform that today. And it's not our right to necessarily always ask why. You know, sometimes that is very private. So that's just one of the things I think is a resource is yourself, is to honor your feelings, is to honor what is going on inside of you. And if you can't get to a therapist, if you can't get to a clinic, if you can't get to an organization and you're in your classroom, to know that there are protections on campus, to know what rights you do have, you know, and that's important, and to break down that stigma a little bit.
I just want to add from a systemic standpoint, I think people need to be introduced to these topics much younger, right? I know we are in a university, but you know, emotional intelligence courses when you're young, or make people take those courses. I know of colleagues working professional football clubs, soccer clubs in the UK. Every week they have a well-being check to 11 years old, 13 years old. It's a generation change. So these young athletes, they have a well-being check every week. They have being taught about self-talk and resilience and confidence and self-respect and values and non-compromise values. I don't compromise self-care. That's a value I don't compromise, right? So once we need to educate people on that, right? I came to learn these things, you know, later in life, you know, if my master and my PhD, I wonder if we're teaching kids 11 years old about some of those concepts. That's one thing. The other thing I want to talk about that relates to what Peter just said, I talk about the systemic level. For individual level, we need self-compassion. If there is too much perfectionism, we need self-compassion. And when you talk about people, what is mindfulness? Mindfulness, you can boil it down to 2 points: being here and now, presence, and non-judgmental thinking, right? And I always ask people, so what do you struggle the most? Is it being in the here and now, or is it having self-compassion? And I get 50-50, right? Sometimes people struggle being here and now, but sometimes people struggle with self-compassion, but we need to have self-compassion. And the self is very important, right? Self-concept, what you think about yourself, self-esteem, self-efficacy, self-complete. So self-care. But one of the bases of all of that, I think, is self-compassion. And performers lack it. And they lack it sometimes because external regulation, right? And I want to bring back to my point, you know, how can you help people to self-regulate? And we got to give the people those resources. And the sooner the better. I said a lot of things, so hope something made sense.
I'm listening to this obviously through the lens of, you know, having a conversation about art, but this is also, I think, what we're trying to teach all students on our campus, you know, all the individuals, not just students, but I think even young professionals or mid-level professionals, that self-compassion and, you know, kind of having a growth mindset around things is incredibly important, but you also have to give yourself permission to take a break and press pause and not constantly be grinding, because there's ways in which that really takes a toll. You know, Tanya and Peter, you've both talked about ways in which your performing did take a significant toll on your own health. Do you still enjoy performing? Do you still get the same joy out of it, knowing that there was a point where it actually felt more destructive for you? Tanya or Peter, who would like to go first?
I can go first on that. It's a love-hate relationship for sure. I miss it desperately right now. It doesn't mean that I love it when I'm doing it. I miss being able to have that. It's a privilege to have a moment with people and to share something with them in that sense that's you don't really get that very often in day-to-day existence. I miss that aspect of it. The actual performance side of the technical music side. You know, for me, the value of music and what I take out of it is the ability to communicate with people and the connections it brings to people more than the music itself. So I really do miss that. I miss making music with my friends. I miss making music, you know, for people. And, you know, that's the part I really do miss and love.
Yeah, I want to just kind of agree with that sentiment. I found, you know, it came much later in life for me that making art on my terms or with collaborators I have identified as safe made me happy. And it didn't always, you know, speaking of being, we challenge this idea of the starving artist, that there were just some places that I could work with and engage with and have a job that also made me just as happy. I tended to ask myself much later in life, I love being a clinician and a researcher. I absolutely love it. And I love it just as much as performance, but there's one thing that allows me to perform wholly, and that is having asked myself, what is this quality of life? What are things that are important to me? And at some point I was performing for other people. I was performing for this image that I had created in this industry and afraid to step back from it because stepping back was looking at it as I failed, even if it was my choice. And at one point I said to myself, I choose to perform for me. And I choose to allow myself to change careers. The typical person can change a career 2 to 3 times a lifetime. For some reason, artists, we don't allow that to be an option. We just view it as failure. And I want to invite artists to say, like, it's okay to, from 18 to 22, to study art, have some life experience, and then decide, oh, I want to make art, but also I want to go become a surgeon, or I want to become a journalist, or I want to become a writer. You can do both. At some point we have to think about, again, where our happiness lies. And so now I perform sometimes in this very room. I sing and I'm just as happy as when it was, you know, stages in New York or being on set on a television show. I am just as happy being in this room singing for me. But it took, that's a really easy answer to throw at people. It did take a lot of investment in what Edson is talking, what Caroline's talking, what Tanya's talking about with stepping back and answering those questions, which honestly were much easier to avoid for a long time because they were painful.
Can I jump in really quickly on this? Because Peter, I love that. And your words resonate so much with me because I stepped away from my horn for 18 years. Didn't play, didn't miss it, didn't really want it in my life anymore. Because it fed my anxieties. And it wasn't until I too found my people, or in this case, kind of created a space where my people could gather, my people who also struggled with their mental health, that I started to love playing the horn again. And I had sold my horn to one of my students to buy a car so I could go take an orchestra management job. And I bought a clunker of a horn, and I now find more joy in playing, you know, in my late 40s and now into my 50s than I ever have in my life. What a gift that has been to find my space and my people that I'm happy making art with.
You all are speaking from such great life experiences that you've had that have really kind of enabled you to see in hindsight kind of the value of pressing pause or shifting set and maybe even taking a different track. Knowing that there is probably a large number of students on listening in, the costs of education around, you know, getting an education around music can be incredibly expensive. Kind of the auditioning process, the travel process, all of that, and the associated things to support establishing a significant career. There's certainly a mental health or wellness toll, you know, if we think even more broadly about financial wellness that takes on individuals. Can any of you speak to that or kind of what your experience has been like in navigating that?
I would love to, as I'm fairly new to academia. And I'm very grateful to have the job, super grateful. But, you know, I saw an article in the New York Times recently about doctors and there not being enough jobs for them when they graduate. And it made the New York Times. Trump University was sued for, you know, not giving relevant degrees, but there's no checks and balances for the number of people admitted into arts programs. And in a sense, that is just easy money. They look for people that are willing to pay full fees without considering what their future is, because of course, you know, the academic staff and faculty need to keep their jobs. They're not really going to change their curriculum because they've been in it for X amount of years. And, you know, for them to re-educate sort of themselves and sort of what's relevant now. I mean, 10 years ago was very different than it is today. You know, 20 years, and, you know, just to think of the people that have been there, you know, at the school for 40 years, you know, it's a completely different field out there. And what they have to teach is completely meaningful and useful, but is that necessarily relevant in how they're going to make their careers now? And also, just I feel so much sadness for the number of students that are coming into schools, and what are they going to do when they finish? I know how hard I struggled. There was an article in the New York Times written, I think in the early 2000s, about Juilliard 10 years later. And if Juilliard sort of, the most popular, difficult school to get into in the country, and out of their graduating class, how few people are actually still in music 10 years later, much less 20, 30 years later. We had a career seminar in the piano department, and one of my friends that was talking, she said, she's the only one in her graduating class at Juilliard in piano who's still playing. And so, we need the work. We obviously, academia has been a way to sort of give ourselves a platform with regular work, but also at the cost of the students. And I feel that that's something that academia can't really focus on, because it really is a numbers game for them to make sure that the university runs as it does. And I'm going to be fired for saying this, but I worry about the students much more so than I worry about the administration. And I am still worrying about the students. And especially as the pandemic has taught us, we are in such precarious field that, we could have absolutely no work very easily, even if you're fantastic.
Sorry, I was unmuting myself. I'm beginning to wonder just kind of the conversation, the way all of you have had such different experiences, but there's of course overlap in this. Are there things you wish in hindsight that you would have known as you've kind of had your progression? Peter, you made a choice to kind of shift from a career of kind of performance to now supporting performers, and there's a real intersection in what you're doing. Tanya, similarly, are there things that you wish you would have known?
Yeah, there. One of the things that I think I went to my undergraduate program because theater was all that I had known. I had grown up queer, and the theater space was a welcoming space, and that was such an exciting place for me. So my brain went, oh, and then they cultivated and said, you should audition, you enjoy doing this, and I got into a program. And then after working, there was a point in my life where I was like, oh, I need, somewhere I digested the idea that I needed a master's, because everyone was telling me, well, you need a master's to be this credentialed performer. So I went and got this master's program. And at some point in my master's thesis was on why actors like struggle with their health and safe boundaries. That's how my nonprofit was founded, is I was like, what is there? And I just wish I would have listened to the many times that I was like, this isn't making me happy right now. What does that mean? And that can mean a million different things. It could mean just a temporary break. It could mean double majoring. It could mean shifting and knowing that, there are many artists who make art that don't go into massive amounts of debt. And I do think also I wish I would have known that mental health was acceptable. Well, it wasn't at that time, but it was something acceptable to even think about for myself. So I think, again, artists, we take on so much of the responsibility of other people's stigmas on ourselves, and arts are used to heal. So I think we spend so much of our time healing other people that we forget to take our time. I see that all the panelists here at some point struggled with like taking care of ourselves. So I wish I would have just asked, what makes me happy? I know it sounds like a simple question, but it's actually not a simple question, right? It's such a difficult question. And that's, I think we also, again, academia, I do question systemically. I'm just going to throw this out there because I won't get fired. I'm not teaching right now. So I'll take it for you, Tanya. I'll take the hit. I wonder why an MBA student can graduate with 13 grand of debt and have so many scholarships thrown at them. But the average from research that has been done longitudinally on artists and arts degrees are amongst the most expensive in the United States. Why is an undergrad, I'll be transparent here, since it's not BU, I'll throw it out. We taught at the University of the Arts, and our undergrads graduated typically with the midline about $100,000 in debt for an undergrad degree in a BFA of some sort, dance, theater, painting. in what world right now, systemically, is that easily something that they could pay back? And then they are also asked to go get a master's to teach and an MFA, forget an MA if they wanted to be broader so that they had other skills. It had to be an MFA because there's something about a fine artist versus a master of the arts. Again, systemic questions, I think, are our job to ask and to care about the students and their longevity. I think that Juilliard did a great, that article was great. I think that it needs to be broader about just why are we charging these prices for the artists, and why are law and you know, MBA degrees having higher scholarships? I'm sure we can have another seminar on that another time, but systemic questions to ask at this time.
I just want to second what you said about the heart, because we know from research, right? If you're not following your heart, it's more likely you're going to quit, right? That's the basic, that's self-determination theory. So it's very hard place to be, because I think people should follow their heart. My students ask me, Edson, I want to do this. I said, I want to do it. Do it, because it's very hard to be an expert if you're not doing what you like. It's not impossible, but chances are lower. And the other thing you said that I think is very interesting, research speaks to that as well, is dual career, right? So professional athletes, when they finish their career, they don't have anything. So now the discussion is, can we have a dual career or three paths, right? So think about those possibilities. Now, follow your heart, but use your head as well, right? And be flexible in that sense. So dual career is something important. And yeah, I think that, you know, those are two pieces I would like to add. And the problem with higher education, it is a really big problem, isn't it? Because people are paying huge amounts of money, and they, pretty much in every career, you end up through big debts. But if you end up for big debt, doing something you don't like, it's a really big problem as well. So just want to throw these 2 cents out there.
In many ways, kind of, we're talking about the systems that also support the very struggles that artists of all types might have. And, you know, we see it with kind of elite athletes, we see it with all types of performers. I'm wondering, there's a question that was posed, which I think captures it perfectly, that oftentimes mental illness and addiction, for example, interferes with an individual's ability to get help. And of course, it also interferes with their ability to perform well. What roles do you, based on, you know, the conversation about higher education, it's clear, but what roles do you think organizations have in reaching out to individuals or providing resources to individuals who might be struggling? Caroline, I feel like this sits kind of closely with what the mission of your organization does.
When you ask the question, I immediately start thinking about my husband and before we were married and we were colleagues, and what our employer should have offered him at that time, and how they would have responded very differently if he had come to them or had displayed symptoms of another disease, of cancer or kidney disease or something like that. And instead, because of his diagnosis, not because of the need for time off, or the need to adjust some medication, but because of their preconceived notions about his diagnosis, they responded out of fear and miseducation. Certainly anybody with a mental health disorder should, I hate to say obviously, but because it wasn't obvious to them, but they should be given the same allowance for treatment that we, any of us would want for any other disease. I do think that, you know, more employers, I hope now, are kind of explicitly saying to people that we do offer a stigma-free workplace, that if you are struggling, that you can come to me and have a conversation about it, and we can explore ways for you to get help as we would if you had any other physical ailment. But I don't take that for granted.
Of course,
it is what should happen.
Tanya.
I was just gonna say, it really depends on what field you're in, I think. For musicians, you know, we're independent contractors. We get 1099s.
Yes.
So we're replaceable like that. If you can't do it, they have to find somebody to do it. You know, and the later you wait for that, the harder it is for them. They have no need to check in on your well-being. I mean, you're also being told what to play, when to play also. It's not like some creative surge of, this is my program that I wish to play. No. Most gigs are, you're playing this piece at this time, you will show up for this rehearsal, and then you're gone and you leave the next day. I don't think there's a way to change that in the system. I think there's maybe a way to change that amongst colleagues and to, you know, just start a conversation, even start an organization somehow. But, you know, like Musicians Union, for example, doesn't serve soloists. It's for orchestral musicians that are also protected by, you know, the hierarchy of their orchestra as well. And they have a little more checks and balances there and a more regular schedule. I've played one union gig in my entire life. That's it, you know? So I'm here also because I don't see a way out of it keeping the industry the way that it is, because it is so tenuous and it's so individual, and you're just constantly just the struggle of getting enough money to pay your rent makes you do everything. And, you know, like, you want to take a mental health day, but that concert pays X amount and I need that, so you don't do it. And survival is more important than well-being oftentimes.
I just want to be mindful of time. Oh, Peter, did you want to jump in quickly?
I will just make this very quick that Tanya and Caroline spoke to it, but Actors Equity and SAG-AFTRA are also struggling as unions with this conversation, because what many artists do believe once they join unionship that they are protected. Even the industries themselves, the unions are saying, don't have robust mental health support or even rehabilitation support. So if you're a dancer or you know, you break your leg, the supports aren't there. So there's also this belief that unionship will cover you as an artist. It's another kind of feeling of security that's not necessarily there. And still, you are still, you know, 1099ers. And so I think that just, again, conversations systemically within, when you do get hired, asking what accommodations are available. If we just keep asking, maybe people will consider that they have gaps in their, or what are your codes of ethics personally as an organization around these things? Again, it starts with advocacy, and I know it shouldn't be us to have to do it, but sometimes you have to be your own advocate to just allow space.
Okay, just very quickly, one thing that Tanya said, I think we could try to do, in psychology, do communities of practice, right? So I get together with a few colleagues and we talk about stuff. What do I do with this client? And what do I do with this paper, right? And it's confidential and it's safe. So artists can say, let's have a community of practice. We might not have an expert in mental health, but we're gonna listen to each other. We're gonna talk to each other. And you can meet, you know, Saturday, 1 hour, every 2 weeks, and that helps. That can be at the individual level. And at a systemic level, I think we need to have difficult conversations, right? When you read the literature on that, we need to have difficult conversations about diversity and about mental health and about better pay and about whatever else, right? So I just want to say those two.
I think that's such an important point to make, Edson. You know, we're talking about these issues as they affect individuals in performance, but there's also the way in which individuals' identity and intersectionality affects these in such different ways, whether it's for the GLBTQIA+ community, for our BIPOC community, and you know, given the landscape of the world that we have all been living in, it kind of exacerbates many of those intersectionalities. So it's very important to recognize. It is 5:25. I can't believe this time has flown so quickly. This has been an incredible conversation. I appreciate all of your kind of insight and input and your kind of sharing your own experiences. I think, you know, having these conversations as you know, just from a research lens or just from a clinical lens or just from an artist lens, but when there's this kind of experiential component that we bring to these conversations, it makes them so much more rich, but also so much more relatable. So I really appreciate all of you for sharing everything you have. Ty, can I turn it back to you quickly?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you to everyone who joined us for this webinar. Thank you in particular to the five of you, to Carrie, Edson, Peter, Caroline, and Tanya. And again, to Tanya for coming to me and saying, hey, let's do this. Let's talk about this. Let's get this going. I'm struck by so much of the conversation, just on a personal and professional level. So I do want to put this out there. My office is the BU Arts Initiative. And I think that I can speak for Carrie on this. Reach out to us. If you are an artist, if you are struggling, if you are frustrated, if you are not finding resources, reach out to us. And even as Edson suggested, you know, something like community conversations on a regular basis that delve into the issues, you know, and at times we can bring professional mental health experts in, but I just wanna say we're here. We will try to do our best, and that is a part of what we're here for. So once again, I wanna thank you all. Sorry, my mind is just racing with how much and how important this conversation was. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.